In this tutorial, I'm going to teach you three basic operations in Blender, that is moving, rotating, and scaling. I'm also going to show you how you can change the color of your object. The first operator we're going to use is move. And I just start with the default scene of Blender. And here on the left, you see this four arrows icon. So when I click this, I can drag my cube in any direction I want. So when I hold down my mouse here on this red arrow, you also see on the left that I'm holding down my left mouse. And this is helping you to know what I'm pressing on my keyboard or what I'm doing with my mouse. So now when I drag, you see I drag among this red line, which is the x-axis. If I want to cancel the operation, I press escape, and then it just jumps back to its position where it was before I start dragging. So when I hold down the mouse and I release it, I've moved the cube. I can do the same from the y-axis and also for the z-axis. If I want to undo this, I press Ctrl Z a couple of times and then it's back in its original position. If you hover on this icon, you see that there's a shortcut. It says Shift Spacebar or G. G is for grab, so therefore they use the G key. What you'll notice is when you are in the select mode and you press the G key, the arrows you've dragged in the previous example are not there. So now you can freely move around over the X, Y, and Z axis. As you see in the top left, you can see the distance where I'm putting my cube. With ESC, you can cancel the operation. This is not very easy because you are moving in a 3D space. So it was a lot easier when we were dragging these arrows, but we can solve this. If you press the G key followed by the axis you want to move, so that is Z for the Z axis, X for the X axis, and Y for the Y axis, you can lock the axis on which you want to move. So I press G, now press the Z key for the Z axis. Now you see I'm locked on the Z axis. The same goes for the X axis when I press the X, or the Y when I press the Y axis. Same goes as with the other operation. When I press with my left button again, I confirm the movement. I undo this with Ctrl Z. So in that way, you can easily move around among a certain axis, and you don't have to switch here to this move operator. And it's quite easy because otherwise you're moving all the time to your tool section here on the left and back to your object. What you see here is that we also have a grid, and when I'm pressing G and, for example, Z for the Z axis, then I can move along, but you see that the distance is a floating point. You see now 2.275, for example. Now, when you hold down the Ctrl key while moving, you see it snaps on the grid, so it moves now exactly by 1 meter. So that's also working for all the other axes. But it is fairly useful if you want to align stuff on the exact positions. What you also can do is just enter the distance you want to. So for example, when I press the G key to move, the Y key to move among the Y axis, and when I press 2 on my keyboard, so that's just the 2 on your keyboard above the Q button, then you see that I've moved 2 meters. And on the top left, you see there the 2 with a pipe behind it. So when I press backspace, you'll see that I remove the 2 and I can, for example, enter 5. That pipe is your cursor. So it's just like you entering in a text box. So when I erase this and I press 0.5, I move 0.5 meter. So it shows 50 centimeters among the global Y axis. So in that way, you can easily move around stuff with exact numbers. And you'll see in a minute when we're starting rotating that is very useful. We can do exactly the same with rotating, which is this icon here. With rotating, the shortcut is R, and you can see here the circle. So this green circle is among the Y axis, the X axis, and the Z axis. So by holding down my left mouse button, I can just drag and rotate my object. Also, when I hold down Ctrl, you'll see that it uses steps of 5 degrees, so it makes it a lot easier. I can cancel the operation with Escape. And also, you can use what I did before, the short key. So if you're in select mode and you press the R button to rotate, you can freely rotate around all the axes. But when I press the X key, for example, I rotate among the X axes. You also see that this is a floating point. When I hold Ctrl, you see there are steps of 5. Now, if I want to rotate this cube 45 degrees, I can just press 4, 5 on my keyboard. And then you see the same as we had with moving. On the top left, you see a cursor, and I've entered 4, 5. I can also enter, for example, when I use backspace, 30 for 30 degrees. And so in this way, you can rotate among all these axes. I press Esc to cancel the operation, exactly the same as we did for move. The last operator here is scaling. So scaling, you can just do the same as you do with move and rotate by dragging one of the axes. You see, for move, there were arrows and now there are some kind of cubes. So if I drag here, you see it drags symmetrical, so it moves symmetrical in both directions. In the top left, you see how much I scale in a certain direction. There's also a short key, as you can see here, the S key. So when I'm in select mode, and I press the S key and I press, for example, X to lock the X axis, you can drag and then you move among the X axis. Same goes for the Z axis, and when I press the Y, for the Y axis. I can confirm with my left mouse button, and again, I can use Ctrl Z to undo. And when I press the S key, and I want to make it twice as big, you just type 2. So now it's twice as big because it's scaling among all axes. On the top left, you see the 2. So I'm using backspace, press 0.5, and 0.5 scales it down by a half. So when I press Escape, I cancel the operation again. So for this example, where we're going to align with the camera, I'm going to scale my object. I'm going to scale it among the X axis, and you now should know how that works with the short keys. I press S to scale, X for the X axis, and I'm making it like this. The dimension doesn't really matter, it's more for the exercise. I rotate among the X axis, holding down Ctrl, and we're going along like, well, what are we going to do? 55, well, make it 30 degrees. So now if I go here to the render menu and render the image, we're going to see how the camera sees our scaled object. So if I press render, we have to wait for a while, and then you see that my block is kind of off the camera. On the bottom, you see it's kind of cut off. So I'm closing this window, and what I'm now going to see is how the camera sees this. So here, I click on this camera icon, and you also see numpad 0. So if you want to switch between your 3D view and the camera view, you can just press numpad 0. That's a lot faster. So I'm going to press this numpad 0, and then I see it doesn't really fit into my camera. So I'm going to move it a little bit upward with pressing the G key and then the Z for the Z axis, and then I see it still doesn't fit. So now I press S to scale and make it a little bit smaller, and then it kind of fits into the camera. Again, you don't need to do this exactly on the millimeter, it's more that you know how you can scale and move stuff in the camera. Now I see that the camera is a little bit off center with my object, so I can move the object. But what you also can do is move the camera by selecting with your left mouse button here the edge of the camera. Now when I press G to move, Z for the Z axis, and I move a little bit upwards, now I see that it's perfectly fit inside the camera view. I can also press the camera again to switch back to my 3D view, and now I can just move around whatever I want, for example by holding the center mouse button, so it doesn't affect any way the rendering will show because the camera is what actually is shown in the render. So the image we've just made is kind of boring. The material of our object is just plain gray. So what we're going to do is change this into another color. So what I'm doing is I'm going to select with my left mouse button my object, and then I go here to the right side of my screen, and here this kind of, yeah, checkered, what is it? Checkered ball. When you click on it, it's the material property window. And here you see that we have a material applied to our cube. Well, it's not a cube anymore, but the default cube, and this is the default material. And there are a lot of properties. You can scroll down here and you see there are a lot of properties. You can play around with it. You can damage your computer or whatever by changing these properties. But what we're looking for is the base color. So if I click on this white here, you can see I have a color wheel. And when I'm dragging this, for example, to the red, I can pick my red value. So you can say red or a little bit more orange or whatever you want. You can make it blue, green, whatever you like. And here this right side is more the brightness of the color. So now I get a very dark red. And when I'm going up, you see it's a very bright red. So I like the bright red. So now I've changed the material color to red. So here it doesn't show red, but when we render the image, you see it will be a red cube. And now you also see more of the shadow, because the gray previously was kind of the same as the background of the image. So now you see a very sharp image with our red cube. So I press Esc to cancel, because what is quite annoying is that we can't see it here. So on the top right, you have several views. Or views, yeah, it's shading in your viewport. So when I press the first one, we get the wireframe. So now I can look through my model. And here, the second one is viewport shading. That's what we had previously. It's the default setting. The third one is viewport shading, but it says you show the shade material preview. So if I press that one, you see it will become red. And this is just the red of the render, but you can also say you want to actually render it. So this is just the material preview. And the last one is actually rendered. So when I press that one, you see the shading is exactly the same. But when you have complex scene, this is getting very slow when you're moving around. For example, when I hold now my middle mouse, you see that it's very, very smooth. But if it's a larger scene, it gets slower and slower. So sometimes you say viewport shading is enough, or even a wireframe is what you like. So that concludes this tutorial. You've learned how to move with the G key, rotate with the R key, scale with the S key, and when you hold down Ctrl, you're snapping to the grid. You also learned that you can undo with Ctrl Z, and also that you can see what the camera sees when you use the numpad 0. You've also learned how you can change the base color of your object. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments, and in the description of this video, you'll find more information about everything I told you in this video. I see you in the next tutorial.